I hope España never sees any kind of formal snowballs. It will be seen from the short of any speaker, but I hope that it will come up to the end of the session. The other thing, pretty much, now we have lots of other big scale of differences between species. Now we go deeper, we go to small scale, we go to differences between species. And I have said this in the context of ecologic restoration. We as humans managed like effectively to destroy many habitats and kill a lot of species on this planet. And the biggest killer of the biodiversity of the species are over exploitation, agriculture, development, invasion, and disease is the cause. But only then goes to stuff like pollution or climate change. And you can see actually all these three are something that has to do with habitat degradation. My impact is simply we destroy what is there and often how it looks like if it's something like this. There is general agreement that to sustain ecosystem services on this planet, it's not enough just to protect nature that we have, but we will need to restore nature, actually create nature again, that there is the achievement of sustainability. The need of restoration is recognized, also politically, and it is part of the IUCN biodiversity target, which also the European Union and states signed. The target is to restore at least 15% of the degraded ecosystem till 2020. Most likely it's not going to be achieved, but it's the first time. This is the task for ecological restoration as a discipline, and it's the process of assisting the recovery of an ecosystem that has been degraded, damaged, or destroyed. When you have some degraded habitat, which looks like this, or wildlife fires in the US, or mining activities, to change it into something that looks like natural existence that it grows. It's usually not a very important produce plants or seeds. Here in Germany, this we have on another small scale, you can imagine the highway, here you go, highway, you have the sites around the highway, or construction sites, compensation sites, you know, like this. But then, on a little bit bigger scale, it is the brown coal mining areas. But here we are still on the tiny scale. In the US, in the western part of the US, there were wildlife fires this season, and there burned approximately an area which corresponds to 1/3 of an area. It's just burned. It was partly caused by the distribution of invasive plants from the sector, that is in the dry areas. And to restore this, they need 2,200 tons of seeds to restore this. In Australia, there is a problem with mining because the companies often don't restore the mines, and then the numbers are actually similar. So that would mean for restoration is running out of the area. But where to take the seeds and which seeds are actually the best for restoration? There is general agreement, at least among biologists and restoration specialists, among scientists, that we should not use exotic species. Because remember now we are in free nature. We are not in town, we are not in urban areas, we are in free nature. And the aim is to create functional ecosystems. Why not to use exotic species? Because they might become invasive. These are, for example, from Europe. These two species, Palpia and Impatiens, they are very invasive. And This is a picture of a stream where actually next to the stream you don't find any native species at all. There are just these two species. And I don't think that here we can talk about some functional ecosystem but about biodiversity. So in very free nature there is generally an issue about the species. So we are now back in the native species. The most common clay was and still in many parts in the US still is Susanka Goldilocks. What are actually Goldilocks? It's a group of plants that was selected for certain traits. It was specifically bred for certain traits. These traits are different from other plants, very specific. What is most important, these traits are stable over generations. So the offspring looks the same, the offspring looks the same, the offspring looks the same. Basically, all the plants look the same like this. And I think you agree with me that this doesn't look very much like functioning ecosystem either. Because the plants look all the same. Then you take mature plants. This is how this is done, but you can take white clay, margarita, or any other native species. They usually, it is the same species, but they are, it is the same, but the same thing, but different, right? It is, when you go somewhere to the north, the plants will look differently than somewhere, which are in the south. Besides that, this is the same species. They grow under the same conditions. But you see that they look different. It's not margarita like margarita. The ones which are in the north will be most likely more frost-resistant, and the ones which grow in the south will be more drought-resistant. And there is many other factors other than climate. And since the plants have grown very growing in the specific areas and specific areas, they are adapted to the area where they grow. So these ones are more drought resistant. They are adapted to the growing in Spain, and this phenomenon is called for adaptation. And when you would, of course, transplant this plant to Sweden and this plant to Spain, although it is the very same species, most likely none of them will survive. The fact that plants are often locally adapted, and this is not on average, this is the case, this is recognized. And for the optimal way to use for exploration, other plants which are local, so Spanish plants in Spain, German plants in Germany, and Swedish plants in Sweden. It is even a little bit smaller scale than Spain. And the use of regional seeds is in law, it is in recommendation of the European Union, and it is also in Bundesland. And there is written that from 1st of May can be used only regional seeds for free nature. What is it free nature? It's not in the town, it's not agricultural soil like fields for the mixtures. But it is when you restore some stray species or anything that goes out, should be regional seeds. It is not only because of the local adaptation, but also to protect the natural diversity, because the different species that die in biodiversity is part of biodiversity as a whole and has a value. But for some people more, for some people less, but it is a value. From that reason, that we should use regional seeds, generally was divided into plentiful seed zones, so called helpful failure. This like with the line, or with the line. And making these seed transfer zones, or whatever you want. These helpful failure are grouped into production. It is because when a farmer or someone produces seeds, it is easier to do it for a larger scale. So we can produce seeds for these for multiple one from China. You can buy these seeds. There are these two certificates. Several companies which actually sell the original seeds. How do you get the seeds? The simplest way how you can get the seeds is to harvest them one. So we go out, collecting all these pictures from the US, from Greece. They go with threshing up, threshing machine, which they harvest the seeds in the world. But I guess that quite some are wondering when we need so many seeds, that actually it might affect the population itself when it when we simply take too much, too many dinosaurs from it. We may see the market of the population itself, and the social population are unprotected because here in Germany is some nice share of oxygen with high biodiversity. I was asking myself, I was asking this question as well. I tested it using one matrix models. I'm not going to be detail. I will just tell you that, there are data, I use data on 208 species total, and these are only data from outside the Earth. But behind each data set are people who went outside to the field. They mark the plants, look how it grows to the next season. And I use this data to model how much actually you can harvest. The first step which I did was that I tested what happens to the population when we follow the recommendations and the rules, how much you can harvest. In Germany, it is possible, it is allowed annually harvest 2% of seed production for animals and 10% of perennials, that is. In Australia, they have rules only for the species, and that's 20% you can harvest annually. And in US, there is 20% without harvesting. These are the results. This is Germany. So, if in annuals, if you follow the rules, you reduce the population size. And it is important to know that this is not absolute, but it's relative decrease compared to the size which we reach without seed harvesting. So, if the population is growing, then the growth goes slower, the population is decreasing, then it increases faster. So in annuals, the population, the relative population size in 30 years will be between, let's say, 55% to 80% of the size which would be without seed harvest. In perennials, if we follow the rules, it gets a bit more tricky, it's because it has this average cost pretty much down. In Australia, they are going to say, the decrease in good plants will be rather small. So, if the rules in Australia are definitely okay. Most worried are the rules from the US because they don't specify the landscape effects. And for good species, it's fine. For perennials, you can pretty easily kill the population when you follow the rules. And for annuals, you have very high probability of killing. So definitely some of the rules need changing and we are working on basically setting the rules that but it is clear that the wild harvest that will have it will not cover the demand. But for that reason seeds are produced. And in Germany are produced they follow this diagram. They have the producer harvest at least 5 large hectare populations in the season, in the second period, makes it a seed to bear, and puts it on the field, And they treat it agriculturally harvest, sometimes with some water, sometimes manually, sometimes with a machine. Different kinds of species. And from the F1 cultivation, they have the F1 seeds. as two congregations, as two seats, they are now they have been out at the different side. But it goes up to five congregations and here's the cap. They can't go over the public generations, which is really good. Because there might be some unintended erosion, but actually there is. The plans do change, but it is not too much. But for example, in the US, they are motivated for every generation. And there it gets good. But anyway, this is how seeds are produced. This is when you get when you order the seeds. And you can get all of seeds, you can get tons and tons. But have you ever seen seeds of this everything? But even almost 40-year-old of seeds of Kampala. Do you know the seeds of Kampala like that? But when I ask the seed machine which you get, do they actually, does it work? Do they fulfill the ecosystem services? So, it's actually a differentiation. Our seeds from Hamburg, which you buy from the person which you from somewhere in the north, are they different than seeds which you get from here from the beginning? Is it really true that these produce seeds do they grow better than if they would be sold from other regions? And what is actually the possible impact on my own interactions? I don't start with the first question. Our plants from individual regions change to the tension. We took eight species. Planted them in we did DNA analysis in a DNA protein of each of the origins. Here's the result, it was work from Costa in Holland. How to make this gap? We are the regions. We work with the production rounds in this study. The same color means like a cluster. And the different shades of the color means the clusters, so it means like the two, and then further down. You can see that it goes into two species. There is a common pattern, north versus south, in many species. So here. There are differences. They are different in local, but in locals, only this differs, here differs from this one, but in actually measuring the species, you get quite a number of those from the clusters. And because the regional seeds are fair, the rules are valid for all those species. When you put each of these maps over each other, then actually it's in one species, the regions will be always unique. So they are differentiated and it looks like that they have the same size. The second question, do regional plants grow better than the original? For this, we planted again the same eight species in the origins, and we planted them to the eight gardens across Germany. One garden was also here in Freising, and Johannes was responsible for it. We looked how actually the growing side affects the performance of the plants. Yeah, the result, this is kind of humble. This is like graphic art to make it easy to read. So, hypothesis, regional is better, performance decreases with geographic distance, the ones which are closer grow better than the ones which are further. Performance decreases with geographic distance, again, one from Northern Ohio grow better than the ones from Northern Ohio. It's the limitation of measures of kind of regionality for two fitness measures. Each of them does something very good, they're different, but we use the two measures to be on the same side. Green means that the regional plants do better PS, regional plants would make sense. Red is the non-regional plants do better, means it would be better results from the solar plants. But you can see that there is mostly no selectivity. of these South-Indian countries, the great islands. So therefore, almost all species except one were within 500 significant reserves. And this was because this species differs in poiding. So basically they can start overnight by the poiding differences. You can see your connotation. So yes, the region of one to grow. But here climate change. And farmers are going to face for higher temperatures than they are facing now. One of the idea of restoration ecology is so-called predictive governance. It means that you simply say, okay, in 30 years we don't have the temperature which will be 3 degrees higher, so we sort the seeds from higher, which is correspondingly higher as the one which is predicted here in 30 years. And we could test this, because the 2013 was very, very hot year. In that time, it was the second warmest year on the record. Now, the years after that, even more, but in that time, it was the second warmest year. In all the gardens, the farms faced temperatures which were 1.5 or 2 degrees warmer than what they were used to. So what we did, we took the plants basically from the bulk of regions which we had available in the garden. I just analyzed the difference in the way that I took seeds, that I took the plants which come from the warm area and compared them with the local parts, with the regional parts, with the local parts. And if the predictive governance thing, the climate change is actually true, then the plants from warmer area should grow better than the local ones because they simply have a similar climate. Here the green means that climate adaptive parts are better, regional parts are better are red, and grey is not significant. I was completely puzzled. Because this part of the plant faced so hot temperature. Because the climate was really extreme, stable. Either there were no differences, or the regional plants performed better than the actual non other species. The warm adaptive or the climate adaptive plants performed better than the regional ones. Why? I think the simple thing, we assume that all this climate measuring idea assumes that the main driving force is climate. And climate is definitely important, but there are other factors like biotic interactions, soil or pathogens, but actually I don't know. I would invest it, I would like to invest it in part of the solution. But what is actually behind? What are the answer? But it looks that we should not rely only on climate. So, do regional farms grow better than the region? Yes, and it seems that we need other climate change. And the third question is impact on biotic interactions. So far, we have been talking only about plants, but actually, about the previous talks. The plant is the focus. But remember, ecosystem restoration seeks to restore ecosystem. There are also other places in the ecosystem. There are bees, butterflies, there are birds. There are many other of different topic models, like this people, this elephant. This caterpillar is the plant, this caterpillar is what? And actually, can plant origin affect these biotic interactions? Why it should, right? It's just the same species. But this is an example of Canaria and even from Japan. The Canaria has variants in the pericarp, how thick is actually pericarp. Here in the north, the things that they pick by card, photos are huge. They are so small, but in the south, they are huge. They are very big by card. Anyway, we have a leader. In the south, in the north, it's enough for the leader to have the short classroom, to have short classroom, because it needs to actually drill through the paper, to the seat. And the seat, and then my head, because the fly head is the seat. But here in the south, these guys need to have a long classroom, because otherwise they will get through. And then imagine that you would sweat the camera. That means a short camera for a trip from here to the north. But the camera would survive, right? Everything would be just the face, the rail, and the legs, and the locomotion. If you would sweat, if you would put guys from the. Simply, so either camera can't produce these, or the vehicle doesn't have anything to eat. And if you remember when I was talking how huge fires are supposed to be restored, then you actually effectively kill the vehicle in the area where there are some random populations. And you would put like several hectares of the rock to camera up to kill the vehicle. But since you care about that system, we do care also about the vehicle. We did several things, but with Centaurea, a common species, and it has sea herbivores that separated flies, and a female of sea herbivore of the separated flies lies egg into the flower head. Then it all flower head, and then hatches, eats the seeds into the flower head. The flower head and into or on the surface of the flower head. And there, sometimes the lion takes some hormones which just makes the flower head can't do anything, can't move, it can't do anything, but it's life and it doesn't feel bad. And then the flower head of the bus eats the flower head, it sounds a bit like from the movie of. We took the flower heads, put them to vials, to a hatch, what actually comes out. We determined that the species, two more hatch instead of my transfer to molecular technology because I would be able to tell it apart. So, thanks to these guys. And then we quantitatively analyzed it. Here are the results. On the x-axis, you have the ecotype identity. On the y-axis, is the herbivore infestation rate by 2 centimeters. You can see that there are differences. They correlate with the infestation problems, with the pathology. So the plants which started to flower earlier are more often infected by this species, the ones which flower later. And it's also a microbic model, not only the ones which eat the plants, but also the plants, the ones, the bats which eat the larvae which eat the plants. There are also differences. And we know that they have shown that there are these differences in the skin herbivores are affected by pathology. Here are this concept of flowering for all the species in the experiment. But all the phosphates which are thin, there are significant differences. It's all except one in here was again driven by the polyphenol. So we can expect that actually in almost all the species we don't have some effect on the interactions with polyphenol. So with the question just a certain is there any impact on our interaction? Yes, or it is important not only for the herbivores but also for parasitoids as the third of the forest. So it seems that regional output will work. So this is the conclusion. Thank you for your attention.
This was a very small scale now, almost like science fair. Was the ballerina or whatever the distance saving same thing. Questions? Yeah.
Ich bin ein bisschen vorhanden, also die Interaktion zwischen Tier und Pflanze ist ja sehr wichtig, aber wie kann man davon ausgehen, dass die Tiere bei dem Klimawandel nicht aufwandern? Also ich hatte mal einen sehr interessanten Vortrag gehört, dass die Tierökologen forschen, dass mit dem Klimawandel relativ viele Tiere von Südeuropa jetzt in unseren Bereich reinwandern werden. Und dann haben sie sogar überlegt, ob man ja so Wanderwege mit den dazugehörigen Futterpflanzen vielleicht vorbereiten könnte. Also ich weiß nicht, ob man das machen kann, aber es kann ja auch sein, dass unsere Pflanzen aus Süddeutschland Tiere meinetwegen Richtung Norden weiter wandern. Und das kann man ja gar nicht planen. That's true. The thing is that if the flowers migrate themselves, they do migrate, then there is also some kind of evolution towards the north. And they migrate together with the plants. But what do you do? Maybe just some phenotypes would go to the north. And so do also the species. So the animals. But what you do actually in this predictive economy, which is that it can predictably put it there and you don't give it a chance to actually adjust to the determination. What would be maybe make a bit more sense is to prepare habitat for room, make some kind of stepping stones, but this like brutal taking from somewhere and put it into somewhere. Especially when you have around habitat and this in Germany only. If you have some perennial habitats around with the same species, I do not practice.
In your study, you looked at the Herkunfts region, but you studied the Produktionsform. What about genetic differentiation or different genetics within this production rooms?
And that's the very good question. And in the now the regional status is actually the whole system is now a development. And at the time when we got the seeds, it was not the aim was actually to get multiple origins seeds or actually to get happen very on, but it ended up on the fabric seeds and go very on. So we did it on the hypothetical level, on the production level. We planned to do it a bit deeper, and I saw some publications that I think was which actually looked at one or two species of the genetic differentiation with them, the production level, and then a rough verdict for all the genetic. Yeah, but I can't tell you anything. They are different, and we don't actually also want to do it. But we still do it. But it's actually it's very good question. It's not the same for all.
Ich fand es sehr interessant, wie Sie Herkünfte von der Alpenpflanzung genommen haben und geschaut haben, wie weit die besser adaptiert sind Wir haben so ein ähnliches Problem für historische Gärten. Wir fragen uns, was eigentlich an Gehölzen in Zukunft dort stehen sollen. Ist es gebietseigene, sind es aus Wärmen, Zonen, sind es gar Exoten, was funktioniert. Deswegen haben wir jetzt als Parameter die Mitteltemperatur genommen. Ich frage mich so ein bisschen, ob sich, was wirklich der Key Factor ist für das Überleben bei einem Klimawandel, ob es wirklich die Mitteltemperatur ist. Ich glaube, ich denke nicht. Ich denke, das sind andere Key Factors wahrscheinlich viel entscheidender. Haben Sie da schon Ideen dazu, was man da in welche Richtung das geben könnte?
In dem Experiment, das war, it was for the mean temperature of a growing season. So it was not like a minimum temperature in data, because we wanted to have a response in the ground over summer. So there, I think the mean is just to be used. Of course, yeah, absolutely, I have been work with food, with food, it's the orange, and then I can also see that we how much it is. But this is still being, we didn't include in our system, it was not necessary to include. I know there are people in these stuff which are very specifically focused on the second of.
It's been in this species. So it is found. It's found. You can tell it. So, I suggest you to get this up. Katharina, nochmal, dass du es verstanden hast. Ja, es war ein Schmeck, also kriegst du extra ab. So, ich habe mich nicht so gut.